My name is Pat Ryan. Welcome to Chicago Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's new digital startup hub. We're having our third Founder Stories. We're sold out once again, and so we are videotaping it for people who aren't able to get here tonight. If you haven't seen the first two, we did Grubhub Founders, Mike Evans and Matt Maloney, as well as Open Table Founder Chuck Templeton. Both of those are available online. You can see them. And for anyone who misses tonight, you'll be able to see this online. But we have a real treat for you today, a great entrepreneur, a great story, and my former neighbor in our building. Our companies were in the same building for a year, Bryan Johnson from Braintree. Bryan, thanks for being here.
Thanks for inviting.
So, Bryan, let's start with your B2B company. You've made a lot of got a lot of publicity with the fundraising, people seeing your success, but a lot of people may not know. What does Braintree exactly do?
We help online businesses accept credit card payments. And so our customers include local Chicago companies like 37 Signals. We work with Living Social, GitHub, Fab.com, Uber, and we power their credit card payments and help them accept money.
I spend a lot more money with you than I realized. So is that the business PayPal's in?
Yes, we compete with PayPal.
So talk a little bit about that, because you know PayPal had a lot of publicity back from its early years. Talk a little bit about what do you all do and how do you compete in that space, because you've had incredible growth in a space that PayPal's been around since the late 90s.
Yeah. The analogy I use in explaining this to people is that 10 years ago when you bought cell phone service, you evaluated the minutes in the plan, whether it was regional or national, and then text messages and night weekend minutes. And that was the criteria. And then after you chose your plan, you then got some free Nokia or Ericsson phone. Now when you decide a mobile phone service, you decide on the phone first, the iPhone or the Android, and the network is secondary. So whether it's Sprint, AT&T, or Verizon that's backing that phone, it's really the phone and the software on the phone that matters. And that's been true in payments as well. So 10 years ago, if you would have got a merchant account, you would have talked to the merchant account providers in the back end. Now it's the software that matters. And so we make software that's relevant for our customers. And so we've caught that big value shift from provider to
Mark Andreessen, software eating the world one vertical
at
a time.
Yeah.
Okay, so talk a little bit. When did you found it? How did the initial idea come about?
It's a long story, but the short version is that I was broke, and as I guess a lot of you can relate with, I was pursuing another company that I'd started, and we were 2 years in without any money, and it wasn't a clear horizon of making money. And so desperate, married and with a child, I emailed the 50 richest people in where I was living, Utah, and I asked them if I could come work for them as their sidekick. I told them I was young and smart and ambitious, and I could just do whatever they wanted me to, because I needed some flexibility to work on my other business. And no one responded.
You'll be one of those 50 people soon enough, so you remember when someone writes you.
I then applied to 20 or 30 jobs. No one was interested in talking to me, and so I couldn't find a job. And so I took the only thing I could find, which was 100% commission door-to-door sales job, peddling credit card processing.
Wow.
And it was really painful. Going into the door, right when I walked in, the owners would typically say, like, oh, you're the fourth guy today that's coming here to try to sell me something. What do you have? And I'd say, well, credit card processing, it'd be even worse. Like, oh, every guy that comes in here, takes advantage of me is dishonest.
What's the closing rate on credit card processing or even door opening rate? Must be tough.
Yeah, it was terrible. But what I did figure out is that the credit card processing industry is this unregulated space. There's no requirements to get in the game. There's no one overseeing the industry. And so you had all these unscrupulous providers. And it's also very complex. So people could take advantage of business owners. And what I figured out is that if I could package honesty, transparency, and good customer support, that sold. And so my pitch was, I'd say, if you give me 5 minutes of your time, I guarantee you I'll win your business. And oftentimes it was intriguing for them to hear, like, hey, what's this guy going to offer me, right? That would be so convincing that I would say, sure, right? I would switch again. And I'd open my pitch book and I'd walk them through from A to Z how the industry worked, who the providers were, what they did, what they did differently. And I was just honest. And I told them how it was. We didn't really have any secret sauce as a company. We had the same products everyone else did.
And was this a software company or more of a service provider?
More of a provider, like a network, like a Verizon or AT&T. But despite that, people bought it because it was a unique pitch. And I became the company's number one salesperson. I broke all their sales records in the first
part-time.
12 months, part-time. They had 400 nationwide, and it's just this formula of honesty, transparency, and good support and it resonated with people. And so I started Braintree based upon that principle of doing the same thing in the online world that I was doing in the card-present world.
And you know, one of the things you see people who come out of industries is sometimes the company starts with more of a sales and marketing element than a tech element. Well, do you guys start, was tech dominant or more sales and marketing dominant?
It was more sales and marketing. I had learned on the streets how to do it. And then we, fortunately, we were introduced to OpenTable. And they had this problem where they had 11,000.
How'd you connect with OpenTable?
I met Chuck Templeton.
Oh, Chuck Templeton.
Yeah, at a local
tech event. Last month's founder stories. What a small world.
Yeah,
Chuck is in every company. I think I'll have to have Chuck be at the Nexus. He is the Kevin Bacon of the Chicago startup scene. he does great stuff, though, much better than Kevin Bacon.
Yeah, he was an advisor to the company for the first 2 years. He's a great guy.
Terrific.
I really enjoyed working with him. And he introduced us to OpenTable, and OpenTable had this problem where they had 11,000 restaurants around the world, and they stored credit card data for reservations for restaurants, but if they did that, they had to comply with the industry standards, PCI. And it was just massively complex problem they didn't want to deal with, and so they asked us if we could solve it. And of course, like any good startup would say, we said, of course we can solve that. so they gave us a $1.2 million contract, $90,000 up front, and we developed software for them. And so we
an interesting conversation before I was coming over here, and it was Troy Hennikoff from Accelerate, who knew your business early on, and terrific guy. But he said he was also a customer at one point. And he talked about it from a pain point perspective. I thought it was interesting. He said, you know, the compliance related to this area, which is
a PCI.
PCI compliance. He said it's such a pain point. And he said the idea that you can come in and say, we will take that off your plate, we will give you confidence, security, integrity, and you get a token.
Yeah.
And you just have to worry about the token. He said it was such a compelling pitch. And it seems like you really found a pain point there.
Yeah.
But for OpenTable, you know, a $1.2 million contract, how much revenue did you have?
Yeah, so overnight, right, we had all this money flowing through the company.
And what was your revenue like before you got the contract?
Oh, I think it was, don't tell OpenTable this. I think it was somewhere around $15,000, $20,000 a month, I think in that ballpark.
Wow. And so was that the moment your business model pivoted from sales and marketing?
It was, yeah. And I think it's true that in everyone's life, entrepreneurship or not, that we have these moments of opportunity and of luck. And that was a big one for us. It was a turning point at Braintree, a turning point in my life personally. And we were in the right place at the right time, and we just were very fortunate. And it changed the trajectory of Braintree.
That's great. So you're a lifelong entrepreneur.
I am.
You've had great success at Braintree. But you know, how old were you when you started your first company?
Well, so I guess when I was 21, I wanted to buy a cell phone. And I didn't want to pay retail. I was frugal. And so I called this guy in the Yellow Pages, and I asked if we could meet at the mall. And so I met him there, and I bought the phone. And he said, you know, you've got a lot of energy. Why don't you come sell phones for me? I'll pay you $40 a phone. And I thought, that's great, you know, instead of working an hourly job. And so I sold phones for him for 2 days, and
you're very patient, I can tell.
And then I thought, wait a second, if I'm selling phones for him, why can't people sell phones for me? And I had this thought that forever changed my life. I thought those who show initiative will reap the benefits of those who won't. In other words, if I could set up the structure and I could get the phones and I could create this network, there would be 99 people that would be willing to sell these phones. And so I hired a bunch of college students to sell phones for me. So I got a wholesaler, got the stuff from them, and then gave them to college students. I paid my way through college without really working much. I just simply gave the phones, the salespeople gave them incentive plans, and it was a great first business. But
Tom Sawyer here.
But you know, it worked out well because, I mean, in entrepreneurship, I guess I never understood the value of a fixed wage, like why I would trade my time for a fixed amount of money. I wanted to determine what I was worth, and if it was zero, that was fine. I was willing to accept that. If it was $1 million, that's even better. But I wanted to determine what I was worth. And I also wanted the ability to author life. I think that that's one of the most beautiful concepts that I've ever realized, is that just like J.K. Rowling sat down and created Harry Potter, right? The world we've inhabited as we've read her book. Entrepreneurs do the same thing, right? They create the world they live in, the products and services they create, the people they hire, the culture they create. They are authoring life. And to have that ability, Oftentimes in companies or big companies, you don't have that ability. There's so many constraints, and you get painted in a box on what you can and cannot do. But really, that was everything aligned to, for me, and I thought this was really the path I wanted to pursue. And entrepreneurship has always fit like a glove with me. I can't imagine any other way to live.
Well, they say if you've been an entrepreneur a certain amount of time, a friend of mine said to me, you sell your companies, you're still unhirable, because once people become an entrepreneur, they would never want to go back.
And yeah, you're infected.
Yep. It is. So you're writing the story of your life, which you got a great opening chapter. What's the next entrepreneurial chapter for Bryan Johnson?
I don't know.
After the cell phone company.
Yeah, so with success under my belt, the small success of cell phones, I got a bigger appetite. And the internet boom was going on. And so three other gentlemen and I set out to do a voice over IP company, a lot like Vonage and Skype. And we raised about $500,000 in funding. And we set out, we created a product, we got some customers, we started making some money. And we went for a second round of funding, and 9/11 happened, and it killed our ability to raise any money. But in reality, I mean, I think we did everything wrong in that company. We didn't have the right people. We didn't know what we were doing. We were 5 years too early. I mean, I think we just did everything wrong we could have possibly done wrong. And it was a great lesson of, how, a failure, right? And the frugality of entrepreneurship.
Well, Brad Keywell talks a lot about how in order to be a great entrepreneurial city, Chicago has to understand how you take failure. We were starting on 9/11, rolling out September the 11th, 2001 at 10 a.m. in Washington, D.C. And I can tell you the rollout didn't go so well. We just got back in our cars and came home. But, survival is a hard thing, but it teaches important lessons. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason why I think a lot of people who've been through those struggles, like Brad and Eric were early on, if you learn from them, they make you better. They do make you stronger.
Yeah.
But they should also make you decide, do you really want to be an entrepreneur?
Sure.
It's when you don't show up and a year later get paid $1 billion, you're like, wait a second, where's my glamour?
Yeah.
And as I think we all know, that not a lot of glamour. You just got to love it for the passion of it.
And when we were raising money for this company, one of the investors looked at us and they said, have you ever failed before? And we kind of turned our chin up and put our chest out and said, no. And he said, I won't invest in. And I thought, how silly is that? Why would you want to invest in failures? And I mean, now it's abundantly clear to me that I had no idea what I was doing. And he was prudent, and he shouldn't have invested, and he didn't. So he was better off for it.
Yeah, that's a great point. It's a great point. Okay, so you have this VoIP company.
Mm-hmm.
9/11 happens. What's the next chapter in the Bryan Johnson?
Yes, I wanted to take a breather, but my brother talked me into starting another company. right after there was this real estate developer that had come into our office on a regular basis. There were a bunch of offices in there, and he wanted to develop real estate, but didn't have any money to do it. He had a couple projects underway, and he complained all the time about his inability to raise money. And so we said, hey, we just raise money, right? We know how to raise money, and how easy would it be to raise money for an asset, right? Instead of like this internet thing. And so we set off and we started a company, and we, 3 years later, this is the real estate thing, we launched a $70 million mixed-use project in Utah. It was a massive project, right? In the heart of one of the best suburbs in the state. I mean, prime real estate, beautiful project, and we messed up on the storage of the space. So we set out to sell the product, an empty nester showed up, but there wasn't enough storage. And so sales stalled, the bank got anxious, and it just all fell apart. And that was also the same time I was out in the street selling credit card processing. But, a small success with the cell phone and then two massive failures right after that.
What do you think you learned more from, the success or the failures?
Oh, I think they're all useful. I never dwelled on failure. It didn't weigh on my mind. It didn't discourage me. It was just part of the path.
But you seem very conscious of the lessons, the things you would do differently. How'd you figure that out? What were those things in those early times that you look at and say, boy, the things I learned early on that I did differently in Braintree because I had these experiences.
Yeah.
What are those?
I think so. A couple. One is we didn't know what we were doing with voice over IP, and neither did we know what we were doing with real estate. We were trying to learn on the fly, not ever having done it, which you can do, right? And a lot of companies are successful in doing that. But you have it's an uphill battle to do that. With credit card processing, I was able to learn the industry inside out beyond the streets. So I was able to talk to customers and sell them and learn their pain points. So I learned the industry inside out. Number two, the people you choose to work with is perhaps the biggest decision you'll make, because they'll make or break you. And I learned that very quickly.
That's a great point. I'm on the investment committee of the I2A fund here, and one of the things I ask entrepreneurs who come in, some of you may have come in, is, you know, how do you understand the problem? Have you ever lived with the problem?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have inside-out knowledge, your likelihood of being successful is so much lower, because you don't know what you don't know.
Yeah.
And you're going to learn it on our dime and your blood, sweat, and tears. And there'll be plenty of blood, sweat, and tears and other things to struggle through. I was, Bryan and I met last week, I shared a post I read recently about a company out of Y Combinator called 42 Floors. And it's essentially trying to do an online, taking online the office real estate market. And it was fascinating because the guy had a great idea. He went to Paul Graham. He'd been through YC before, I think. He went to Paul Graham and said, I've got this great idea. This market is meant to be disrupted. It should be online. Here's all the reasons why. And he said, this is a great idea. It sounds great. I don't want you in the next class. I want you to go in the class after that. If you do one thing, go get your commercial real estate broker's license and go be a commercial real estate broker for 6 months and figure out what you don't know about why this market is the way it is. And he got there, and he started out, as I remember the post, basically saying, you know, I'm going to disrupt the whole thing. This is all backwards. We don't need these people. And it was the sense you got, like the classic disruption model. And instead, when you get past the sort of 50,000-foot perspective, he said, there's a real need. These people who are the listing brokers provide a real service to their clients, and they need more eyeballs. They need more people in. And so instead of being a disruptor of all, he became a real value add to the people who had evaluated clients. And now this business just, I think, got $10 million from Andreessen and Horowitz and some others, and they're doing incredibly well. And if you look at it, that inside-out knowledge, I mean, what's 6 months? What's a year when you're talking about spending a decade in building a company? You did an incredible job of being able to fund your company, though, through cash flow.
Yeah.
So one day, though, you decided you're going to take a big fundraising round from a great firm, Excel Partners. Those of you who don't know Excel, it's one of the top venture firms in the world. It was Facebook's original venture capital firm investor, Peter Thiel being their first professional investor. And before that, a lot of people didn't know Braintree.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about why you decided to raise money, and let's talk a little about that process. Because like the last two guys over here, I mean, you're working with world-class venture money, coming in from the coast. I used to laugh because I know when I had a board meeting, because I'd see the limo parked out in front of our building, or the town car, I should say. So talk about why you decided to do it, and why there, and what are the benefits of doing what you've done.
Yep. I mean, early on in Braintree, we wanted to create an exceptional company. That was the goal. And we wanted exceptional people. We wanted our customers to love us for what we do and what we provide them. We wanted people internally to say that Braintree was the best company they've ever worked for. And we wanted to get those two things right. And so I wanted control over the environment. I wanted to set the pace. I wanted to establish the principles and the habits. And so we did it for 3 years. And I think we did a really good job. We got to a point, though, where we were processing almost $3 billion in credit card volume, which in our world is a ton of money. And we started having discussions with banks about what we could do and what we could not do, and we just started hitting some limitations. And basically got to a point where we had so much we wanted to do, but banks wouldn't allow us to do it because we didn't have deep enough pockets. And so I tried to offer my car as, you know, collateral, and they said it wasn't adequate. So it brought us to a point where we had to start reconsidering what we wanted to become as a company. And we settled on the determination that we would raise some money. And we were in a good position because I had been contacted by VCs every day for like the previous 2 or 3 years because all our portfolio companies used us and they would say great things about us. And so when it came time to raise money, we were in a good situation. We were profitable. We had recurring revenue. Our customers were wonderful, growing like crazy. And we really could take money from, you know, pretty much whoever we wanted because we were in a good spot. But you know, the funny thing about funding, as we evaluated the pros and cons of what would happen, the one rule I had is I wanted to control the company. I did not want to cede control, and I wanted to call the shots. And the company I chose had to be okay with that. But one of the unintended benefits of the funding was before we took money, we were nobody. Like, nobody knew a Braintree, and we didn't have any press. And after we took money, like all of a sudden we were someone. People took note of us. And all of a sudden, because we had third-party credibility behind us, we were worth talking to, and so I think in the past 12 months we've had something like 30 pieces of press coverage about us, and we're just on the radar of a lot more people than we thought. And so I never thought that funding would give us that type of visibility, and we didn't take the money for that, but it's been a great benefit because we now are in a conversation we weren't in before.
So talk a little about the process, because a lot of people here would be in earlier stages, but yeah. As they think about getting into, for you, it's probably your Series A, I guess, because you never raised money before, but for most people, that amount of money would be a Series B or Series C kind of dollar amount. I think it was $34 million was what was reported. So how did you decide who to talk to, and how was it being a Chicago company going out to the coast? Was it easy experience or different than you expected? Just talk, and then eventually, why Excel?
Yeah. I spoke to other entrepreneurs for data points, and I wanted to know who was the most entrepreneur-friendly, who didn't pull any punches, who would support the growth, who would let the company culture develop as we desired. And Excel came as one of the most highly recommended VCs out there, and they've been true to that. We have been thrilled with them as a partner. And I had a contact with nearly every venture firm out there because they'd all contacted us. And so it was easy to start conversations. They were there already. And we settled on Excel because they were committed to companies to be who they were, who they wanted to become, and they didn't interfere with their business. And they weren't, they made decisions oftentimes that were counter to their own personal interest, but would benefit the entrepreneur and the company. And I admired them for doing that. And they've done that.
And when you were out there as a Chicago firm, I don't know how many investments Excel has in Chicago now, probably one.
They're also in Groupon.
Oh, right. Well, yeah, a lot of them are the late stage of Groupon. But, did you, did anybody pause at saying, I don't know if I want to go for a company that far away or?
No.
Because, that was the popular wisdom a long time ago. Silicon Valley, major Silicon Valley VCs will only drive to a board meeting. It's interesting to see how that changed. And and so there was no hesitation. That's in the past.
I didn't hear it, but I have heard it from others where companies in different areas where people passed just because they were in, there wasn't a direct flight from their city to their city, so they passed. And that's
why Chicago helps.
I heard it. I heard that today. So
interesting.
Yes, that's real.
Interesting. But for you out there, the firms on your short list all were interested interested in coming to Chicago and the whole thing. That's great. That's great. By the way, Kevin talked about Soapbox, to go Soapbox. If you have any questions, please put them in. We'll get to questions in a few minutes, but it's helpful to have them. Not only so I know what your questions are, but candidly so you can vote, because when the list gets long, it's hard for me to see them all, but if you vote, I'll know exactly what you're thinking. So please do ask your questions. Now, you've made an interesting move. You were CEO for a long time, and you are no longer CEO. Talk about that decision, if you would, as a founder and still controlling it, but not being CEO.
Yeah. Entrepreneurship, it can be soul-crushing work. And sometimes it's really helpful to not know that, because then you wouldn't do it. Other times it's very helpful to know that, because if you are not equal to the task at hand, you'll get crushed. And I ran Braintree for 3 years, and we had zero management in the company. When we hired someone, the rule was, we will measure you by two things. One is how awesome your peers say you are, and the other is how awesome your customers say you are. And if you don't meet that threshold, you're out. We just don't have a safety net in here to put you in another department or put you through a training program. That's it. And so with that type of structure, I was a catch-all account for everything. And after about three and a half years, when the time came for funding, my gas tank was on empty. I had been doing this for a long time. And so my first conversation with Excel, I said, just so you know, right, that my gas tank is on empty and I need someone else to help me. And I've been trying to find someone for 2 years. I just couldn't find the right fit, the right chemistry. And so it was the first thing I said, and I really needed someone to help me run the company.
And where was he at the time?
We hired a gentleman named Bill Reddy. He was actually entrepreneur in residence at Excel.
Oh,
and so they made the introduction, and we explored for about 6 months together.
And where was he coming from?
He had previously run a company called iPay. They did bill pay for banks.
Got it. And you're, from your perspective, getting him to come here, no problems?
We had a great match. He knew the industry. We had a great chemistry between us. He valued our culture, and I think it was just a match all around. And
that's great.
Yeah, so he's been here, been at Braintree for almost a year, and I'd say we have an excellent relationship.
That's great.
Yep.
Well, I've heard great things about him. Now, Bryan, you are have an interesting background. There's no question about it. But I know you're not, like me, you're not a software engineer.
Yeah.
Talk about the challenges and the opportunities or opportunities you feel like that's brought you being a tech entrepreneur.
Yeah. I mean, I think everyone here in this room knows there's a lot of religious discussions about technical founders or non-technical founders and which one is better and why. And I think that there is no one right answer. That if you are technical or non-technical, you can start and create a successful company. And there are pros and cons to both. I mean, for example, I would love to be in the code base right now. I'd love to be coding 12, 18 hours a day. I just would love it. I know I'd love it. But I think that if we put those limitations on ourselves and what we can or cannot do because of what the ideology may be, I think we're placing improper constraints on ourselves.
So what would your advice be for someone out there who's a non-technical person who's looking to found a company? What would your advice be to them to help them be more effective?
Yeah, I mean, you've got to find someone extremely good, and you have to know if they're good or not. Because if you're not a technical person, I didn't know how to hire technical talent when I began, and I've gotten better over the years, but you have to know how to recognize good talent.
So we talked about some of the lessons of your first few entrepreneurial endeavors, at least to date.
Yeah.
And Braintree is still growing and going, but what's the biggest lesson out of Braintree?
Well, I don't know. I don't think I can make up something on the spot.
That's right.
I need to think about that more.
Okay.
So many lessons.
Good. Well, in what you do, you see a lot of companies. You see companies come to you for advice. You have a lot of interesting clients as companies. Are there companies you're really excited about and exciting to watch their futures and growth?
Yeah, I mean, so the cool thing about Braintree is we work with some of the fastest growing and most reputable companies in the world. And so, I mean, GitHub started on Braintree 3 years ago. And Living Social started with us when they were, you know, early on. And so we see the growth of these companies. It's phenomenal. We see all the behind-the-scenes magic. And it's a lot of fun. And we see companies who would never get exposed to otherwise. And so it's really fun to be part of that ecosystem. I think we feel very fortunate to be part of their lives.
Great. Well, I want to work a few questions in here from the crowd. Feel free to put more in to go soapbox or vote for them. One question that came up is, how do you decide when to hire an employee or get a partner? Maybe when you started your business. Like, how did you decide to start? Did you start it on your own? Did you bring in a co-founder? What's your view on the whole concept of a founder,
yeah,
co-founder?
So in my first business, cell phone company, I didn't have a partner. My second business, I had three partners. Third business, two partners. And then Braintree, I started it myself. And if you have the right people to start the company with, partners can be a lifesaver because they help shoulder the burden. And they keep you honest, because you know you can get lost in your own thoughts. But partnerships that go bad, and I had a partnership that went bad, is a nightmare. And even people who have been friends since they were in kindergarten, right? And they say, yeah, they're my best friend, and we go way back. Once you get difficult situations and money's involved, people can change, and it can destroy a company. And so I don't have any good advice other than use your best judgment, because if a partnership goes bad, it can kill the company and be really damaging to you and your efforts personally.
That's good advice. So along that line, early employees, you know, now it's easy. People probably see your success and all, and it becomes much easier to hire. But when you were an idea, a fledgling with little or no revenue and trying to get people to not only join you but to stay, what was your secret? What was the most important way to make that happen? How did you make that work?
Well, I think we have a lot of people from Braintree here tonight, and I think the pitch we made was we said we want the best people around, the most capable people we can find, and we're going to create this environment for you where you can be exceptional. We're going to remove all the barriers, and you can be you. And we're not going to have politics. We're not going to have bureaucracy. There's no drama. I'm not going to be a jerk, and you just do your thing. And I think that was a pitch that resonated with people, and we got really talented people to come and park and to do their thing. And that's why Braintree, I think, had such a great couple of years, is that we really got the right people and let them go.
So, you know, obviously it makes a big difference. And we used to laugh because we have about 70 people on our floor in our building, and I think you guys had about the same.
Yeah.
And so the elevator on 8 and 5 used to get packed, and but you always had great people, and we were really proud of our team. But it seems like you got a great culture and a great, great group of people. I want to take some of the questions here that vote, and the number one question, like I'm announcing a lottery winner, is that the name Braintree doesn't scream payments to me. Why Braintree?
Yeah, this is a good story, a good lesson for me. When I started the company, I was trying to figure out a name, and I leaned towards big names like National Processing Company and Federal, like something that would speak like strong and secure, and because I was insecure of our size, because I was trying to go after big companies. And after going through that a while, I thought, like, you know, this doesn't feel right. It's not, it doesn't mean anything to me. So I wanted to do something meaningful. And I admire the second president of the United States, John Adams, and he's from Braintree, Massachusetts. And so I named it after his hometown, and it was meaningful to me. And so Braintree doesn't scream payments, but it was meaningful to me on something that I thought was, you know, important.
Interesting. First startup ever named after a president that I'm aware of. Very interesting. Great. A question about the the whole micro transaction business. A lot of things about the wallet. You know, if you're 30 cents, the question is, what happens? The current processing fees don't seem to lend themselves to micro payments.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of talk about micro payments being the future of the phone of being your wallet. How do you see that unfolding?
Yeah, I mean, that's been a part of the discussion for a long time. And there's been, I can count like 4 or 5 companies that have been really well-funded that have failed in the space. It's just hard to pull off because the credit card companies have interchange in place. So the minimum transaction, the lowest cost you're going to have is around like 12 or 13 cents roughly on a transaction, the Visa and the banks charge. And so you have constraints within the network on how you can price. So it's not like companies just don't want to. And so without those constraints, I think we could do a lot better. But, you know, if the card associations, Visa, MasterCard, Amex, and Discover are willing to work with microtransactions, we can make it happen. The economics are very hard.
Got it. Another question in that world. Apparently, someone's been on your website while we're here. You got to love that. You have a credit card portability campaign going.
Yeah.
What's its impact, Ben? They even gave me the URL if I want to check it out.
Okay. Some of you may remember, if you had a cell phone before 1996, if you wanted to port it, you couldn't. Your company would hold you hostage. AT&T would say, you can't port it. And then Congress got involved in the Telecommunications Act, and they said, no, companies, you have to port numbers in between providers, right? You can't require someone to have to change all their business cards and stationery and stuff like that. And the same problem existed in the credit card processing world, where if I have a business and I have 20,000 credit cards on file that I'm doing recurring revenue from, and I stored my information with PayPal, and then I find out that PayPal can't satisfy all my needs and I want to go somewhere else, I go to PayPal and say, can I please have the stored credit card data? They say, sorry, Charlie, like you're stuck. And so this company now is in a hostage-like situation. And so we said, why don't we solve this? And so we didn't want to go to government to try to solve it, so we created this portability standard. And I wrote a script for a video. We hired a director on this cheeky presentation of a hostage situation. The Braintree people were the actors in the movie, and we filmed the hostage environment of someone getting their credit card, you know, being held hostage. And so we launched the standard, and we did it. So Braintree wasn't present at all, so it was fair, and it wasn't advertising us. And I wrote an open letter to the CEOs of PayPal and Authorize.net, the two biggest providers we were competing against them. And I said, basically, don't compete on incumbency, compete on openness and fairness, right? Let's have a free market competition. And when we came out with it, everyone basically poo-pawed the idea. They said, there's no way it's going to work. These guys don't, you know, they don't care. You're just a nuisance to them. But it's worked. So in the past, 18 months, 24 months, we've completed a credit card data transfer from every major provider in the industry. And so while they don't openly embrace it, there's a merchants know about it and they bring it up, and it's a big decision-making factor. So it's worked. And so it's always a reminder to me that no matter who you are, no matter what your station in life is, you can make a difference. And that's worked. So now people just know it's part of the industry, and it's kind of forgotten that we started this 2 years ago.
That's great. So I'm trying to learn how to use Go Soapbox simultaneously here, but but I want to make sure I ask everybody's questions, and those are the really great insights to share there. As you look, going back to the whole idea of putting together a founding team in those founding days, because that's where a lot of people are, 107 yeah. companies in this space alone.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about how do you think about putting together that right team? If you were to do it over again, or you were to, you know, give advice, I know advice isn't, you're hesitant to give advice, but a lot of people here would like your advice. So
yeah.
if you were to give advice on how to put together a founding team based on what you learned, what would that advice be?
Yeah, it is such a tricky topic, and the opinions range so dramatically on this. I would say a couple things. One is we all need to recognize that we overvalue ourselves, right? We all think more of ourselves than we probably should. We're probably all overconfident. And so when you get in a situation, it's difficult to negotiate with other partners on what your role should be, what the equity split should be. And those human factors make it more complex. But I would say if you break down the company, you try to identify what is necessary to build a successful company, that's a good first step. The problem with that is that's going to change in 2 weeks from now when you change your business model again, right? And so I think you really need to find people you love to work with, who you can rely upon to work as hard as you, and that you're not going to have a free rider problem. Because if you have a difference in how committed you are and how hard you're willing to work, it's going to create a rift. So find people you enjoy, find people you trust, and find people who are, you know, equally competent as you are.
And when you talked earlier about being good at hiring, learning how to become good at hiring tech talent, what's your advice for hiring tech talent, especially in those early stages?
Yeah, I think I'll punt on this because I'm not the guy who knows best. Our team does a good job, and we've been modifying how we hire. So I think even 2 or 3 months ago, we recognized a bunch of problems in our hiring process, and we're trying to fix those. So I don't think I have a good answer for it. We've tried a lot of processes over the year, and I think we're going to get better.
Well, let's get better every day.
Well, so I guess I would say one thing. I had this conversation with a friend once where he said, he found this brilliant guy, one of the smartest guys he's ever met, and he just wanted to hire him on the spot. And I said, I don't care how smart someone is. If they're not a fit for the culture, if they're a brilliant jerk, it's not going to work. Right? They're going to splash water in other people's eyes in the pool, and they're not going to play nice, and it's just going to cause problems. So culture fit's really important.
Great point, especially when you're small.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit, if you would. You talked about the venture, what venture firms are looking. One of the questions out there is, what do you feel like VCs are focusing on today? What are they looking for when they're looking for a company to invest in? And, what's your sort of experience from the front lines?
I guess it depends. I guess a lot of companies here are early stage and trying to find their footing in a market. Recently, I guess in a couple of years, it's almost been like the lottery, right? In trying to pick the next thing that will virally hit. And I think you find a lot of that mentality in San Francisco or in the Bay Area, and less so in Chicago. I think investors here want a predictable, sustainable business that they can project out and see a path of profitability. And so I think the markets are different, whether you're raising money in Silicon Valley or in Chicago. I think the investors have a different decision set. And some are willing to bet on lottery-style wins in the Valley, and here you have less so. And so I think that you need to decide what kind of business you are, and that's the market you appeal to for raising money.
And from what you all have done, what do you think the venture guys found most intriguing? How do you fit into their narrative?
I mean, for early stage companies, it's all about the people. And VCs invest in the people. That's the single most crucial factor in success. If you hit your strides and you find that you have a runaway success and your business proves itself and they don't need you, anyone can come in and run it, I think that's a different story. But I think it's all about the people.
Great point. A couple more questions and then one final wrap-up here. One is, are you hiring? The question is, and would you hire an entrepreneur with a smiley face?
Absolutely.
Great.
So Charlie Trotter, he's a famous... restaurateur, I think that's how you say it, here in Chicago. He has a theory that he doesn't want employee loyalty. He wants to hire people who want to start their own restaurants. So he wants them to spend 2 years in his restaurant, and he wants them to own the plate. And so they do the front, they learn the entire restaurant experience. And so it's a different take on trying to hire and the kind of people you hire and how long you want them to stay, which I thought was interesting. He flipped the normal convention on its head. But I mean, for Braintree, we're proud that I don't think we've ever had anyone leave the company, which is exceptional. And I know that the day will come where people will leave, but we've created an environment where people want to stay and they feel valued and they contribute, and it's an environment that works for them. So we're proud of that. And yes, so we are hiring for a lot of positions, and we hope that you'll consider us.
Good. Couple more questions, and then we'll go to wrap up here. What was the biggest hurdle for you getting into this competitive space?
Development talent, finding developers that can build software that other developers want to work with.
And you think that's harder here than other places?
So, I mean, there's a lot of religious discussion about the best place to build a company. And we have an idea on how we can solve this problem. We started a dodgeball tournament last year and a half ago. And so we thought, what better way to get a bunch of techies together and throw balls at each other? And so we did it here in Chicago, and we thought, you know, there's always this discussion about where's a better place to start a company, you know, the Bay Area or Portland or New York or Boston. So we said, why don't we have regional competitions in each area? And then we'll bring everyone here in Chicago and settle it once for all, get a national dodgeball champion.
But saw that movie.
Yeah. So I'm not religious about where to start a company. I think you can build a company anywhere. We found great people here who are hardworking, who are loyal, and we've enjoyed being in Chicago. We've also found that we have not been able to find some talent we've needed, in particular in this payment space. That there's just not payments companies in Chicago. So, you know, Google and PayPal and others who have a lot of payment talent, we opened up our West Coast office hoping to get, you know, much more of that talent.
How's that going for you out there?
It's great.
Where are you? And tell us a little bit about that experience.
Yep, so we found a ton of great people so far, and our recruiting efforts are picking up, and I think we're getting a great team out there.
Great. How big is it now?
I believe we have 10 people.
That's great. Yeah. We opened up in Austin a couple years ago, and you know, a lot of talent, and great. I mean, just they have great work ethos and just, you know, great people. We couldn't be happier. Some of them are here tonight. It makes a big difference. It is kind of funny for them to say, I work for a Chicago company. two last questions here. One last one from the crowd is, would you feel free, obviously, not to answer, what's your exit? Or do you ever think about that? Do your venture people ever think about it? Is that something you're ever comfortable talking about?
Yeah, sure. I think that as an entrepreneur, I guess as a human being, there are thoughts that can pollute the mind. And I think focusing on exit pollutes the mind, because first and foremost, you have to build an exceptional company. You have to be focused on building value. And if you get distracted and you start making decisions on how I'm going to sell my company or position it for selling, you're going to make wrong decisions for the company. And so I don't know what's going to happen to Braintree, but we are focused on building an exceptional company, and we want to stay focused on doing that, because I think we'll make good decisions by doing that.
Great. One last question. I think it's been a great conversation. You shared so much. For a guy doesn't like to give advice and doesn't believe in sharing advice, you've shared a lot of great insights and experiences, so thank you. But sort of a two-sided question to end it, which is, what's Braintree look like in 5 or 10 years? Like, what's your big picture vision of what Braintree can be in a decade?
Yeah. We don't look out a decade. I think it's too hard in our space, but we look out a couple years, and we think that mobile will be a defining shift in payments, and the ease of completing a transaction on a mobile device. And there's been a lot of attempts to simplify it. We have some things in the works we're trying to do, but we're focusing a lot on mobile, and we think we have some solutions that will work to help merchants increase revenue, to help consumers make a frictionless transaction. Mobile, but we also think that there's this convergence of all these technologies that have been growing, social personalization, data aggregation, that will merge with payments. Because today, payments is a dumb transaction. You just exchange money. But it can be so much more of a rich experience. And so I think that you'll see more convergence with these technologies, and payments won't be a standalone product. It'll be bundled with a bunch of other things in more of a tight ecosystem.
Great. So you've, it's obviously exciting. I can't wait to see what that means. I'm sure there's really exciting things being built built at Braintree for that. And we're obviously rooting for you as a Chicago company. But you've had a lot of different careers now.
Yeah.
Four companies, plus a couple of interesting jobs in the middle.
Yep.
You're still a young man. You know, what's the future hold for you? Where do you see your, are you going to do more companies? Will you give back in some other way? Like, where do you see the long term? I don't mean as specific, like what job we do in 10 years, but what's the, what when you look at the next chapters of your life, what do they look like?
Yeah, so I'm not motivated by money. I want to determine what I'm worth, and I want the ability to have control of my time. So as long as I have enough money to control my time, I'm satisfied. My sincerest desire is to be useful, useful to society. And I love the Margaret Thatcher quote where she says it used to be about doing something. Now it's about being someone. And I hope to stay true to trying to do something, something larger than myself and being useful to those around me. And so I have a few things I'm working on and a few ideas, but that's what I really aspire to and what drives me.
I'm sure you will. Thank you so much.
Thanks.